Hi, good afternoon. I think most of you know me already from the previous conferences, but I still have to give you a little bit of background. So I'm a committer and PMC member of the Apache Lucene project that it also includes Solr. I started with implementing the numeric queries. So that was very long ago. In 2008, I started to invent those numeric queries, which are now replaced by a newer version, which are the point fields, but that's my background. And I'm also working a lot on Elasticsearch, but I'm not a committer there. I'm just contributing code from time to time. And I have a company for consulting in Lucene, but I'm also doing long-term archiving of scientific data, which is where the numeric queries are coming from, because you want to query something like time series. Okay, so this talk is about Java 9, and now we already have Java 10, and soon Java 11 will come. And as most of you have already recognized, there are a lot of changes in the backend infrastructure of the Java Virtual Machine and also the class library, which makes it hard to migrate some projects. This was also a problem at some points for Lucene and especially Solr, because Solr is depending on a lot of external libraries, and you have to verify that everything works with the newer versions. And so I will bring you some of the issues you will also have in your own code when you upgrade to Java 9, 10, or 11. So this is not specific to Solr. It's just in general. So there are also some suggestions. So, and in the second part, I will also talk a little bit about the performance and why you should now finally upgrade your Elasticsearch or Solr instance to Java 11 when it comes out, or maybe Java 10, depends. I will explain to you which version would be the best. So the first thing is, I think that some history about the relationship between Apache Lucene and Oracle and OpenJDK Group. Does anybody remember that date? Yeah. So at that time, there was something. It was shortly before the release of Java 7 on July 29, 2011. Suddenly, in the press releases, there were a lot of blog posts about Java 7 when it was released is breaking completely Apache Lucene and Solr because it corrupts indexes. So you were starting up your Solr cluster, and no, it was not clustered at that time. I think it was only something like master-slave configurations, but your index got corrupt. The most interesting thing was, so people who were calling the help of the Eclipse project at that time, so of the Eclipse IDE, when they opened the help with Java 7, it crashed because Lucene was crashing at that time. So this was just some funny articles. So it started, how can Oracle release Java 7 without testing against open source projects? So you see this here. That was just funny. And the final one was that one by Hossmann, which was released, I think, 3 days afterwards, yeah, July 28. And that was somehow a signal to Oracle there needs to be done something. And after that time, we had some phone calls with Oracle. And then they started to have preview builds for all the new releases. So it's still, you can still do that. You have a weekly preview build. And that also caused that projects were starting to test their stuff against the then coming Java 8 version. But of course, we were also looking at the bug fix releases of Java 7, and of course, later with Java 9. And this was very helpful for the easy and fast bug reporting. So thanks to the Lucene group, we now have a better testing in that case with open source projects. So it's also installed on the Apache Jenkins servers. You can choose all the JVMs to figure out if your project is working. And during the time of Java 8, we also found a lot of bugs, which were also serious. So it could have happened the same if we would not do the testing. And here's something from Mark Reinhold, who is the head of the Java project at Oracle. So the Lucene project with 5 serious bugs in the Java 8, we were the leader of that group. Robert Scholte with Apache Maven was the second one. But in our case, it was more hotspot bugs. And for the other ones, it was bugs around API inconsistencies and all that stuff. So now, but we don't want to talk about Java 8 now. I think everybody is now using it with Lucene because that's a minimum version. So now we want to look at Java 9. So what's new in Java 9? First, we have that, as I already told, we have the module system. What does that mean? Yeah, basically, it's very easy. You have a JDK, and the JDK is split into several modules. And for somebody looking from the outside, there does not really change much. If you run your code, you can simply start it with Java 9, and it should work. Unless you are starting to actually use the module system, which means you are telling the JDK on compiling your classes that you only want to use a subset of the modules. By default, if you use the standard class path, everything is visible to your code, so you can do almost the same like in Java 8. For the first time, they removed some deprecated stuff, but that's minor. So the reason for that was so you can deploy your application. So theoretically, we could ship Elasticsearch or Zola together with the correct JDK and only ship that part of the JDK that's really needed. So we could ship it with a JDK maybe only having some 100 megabytes instead of 300 megabytes, I think, is the download of the JDK. So that would be one possibility that you could use if you use a module system. Currently, we don't do that. But you have to keep that in mind. Because of the module system, they had to start doing some really backwards incompatible stuff. So one thing is, between the modules, you have to export code that is visible to the outside, and you also have to import code that you want to see. It's not enough that a class is public. You also have to import the package into your code. And from that packages, you only see that package. So that means if there are some hidden classes in the JDK that you were able to see in the previous versions of the JDK, they are no longer there because they are not exported. I come back to that later. So private APIs are private, and this is especially important for those in the JDK, and that caused most of the headaches we had. And it behaves a little bit like if you run all your code with a security manager. In that case, the disallows to do reflection. See, something like that. So in that case, in the Lucene project and the Zola project, we were already prepared for that because the test environment of Lucene and Zola runs inside the security manager, so we can track calls to forbidden APIs that you should not use or private APIs. We can also track that it does not escape the file system, which is not done by Java 9. But because of that, we already have the infrastructure, so our testing was working almost perfectly well with some small exemptions. So Lucene was compatible with Java 9 from the beginning. It was a little bit harder on the Java side. So because there came a little bit of other stuff. So with build 148, there was some additional restriction. So still, you had the packages in the JDK modules that were not exported to the outside, so you were not able to see it with conventional code, but you were still able to do stuff using reflection. And with build 148, this was disabled completely. So if your code tried to access some private method from some class in the Java class library, you got a new exception, which was also causing confusion to the users, and then your code won't work anymore. This was a little bit relaxed at the end because this was so serious that a lot of code was not working anymore. So currently, if you run your code with Java 9 or later, once something by default calls one of those reflection tricks to get private access to something, it will print you a warning to the standard error console, and you cannot switch that off. So you have to take care. So you are informed about that. Your code is doing bad stuff. But if you are strict, and for example, in Elasticsearch, I think it's enabled by default if you run it with Java 9. For Zola, I'm not sure at the moment for the startup script, but in the tests, we are enforcing that mode started here, so that means you get an exception if you try to access code out of that. But we have to verify in Zola, but I think we have no warnings like that anymore in the code. So the reason for that was that awkward strong encapsulation. That was a discussion about that. You cannot encapsulate something and then still have some access to the outside. So that was the background for doing that. So now we come to the interesting parts, which are undocumented APIs. You remember that is one of the things that really affected Lucene. And you, all of you know, when you're running Lucene, Zola, Elasticsearch on the 64-bit platform, it's using memory-mapped directory behind the scenes, so that means all the index files are mapped into the address space of the virtual machine. So accessing the index can be done directly by accessing memory locations. So, for example, if you want to sort against some doc values field, then instead of loading all the stuff from disk into your heap space and then start sorting, you're just mapping that stuff into the virtual address space, and the Linux kernel is taking care of mapping that in and out, so you can access it as it would be an array in that case. And so Lucene uses the memory mapped directory by preference. If you don't use it, it gets a lot of slower, especially when you do sorting and faceting and all that stuff. So that's one reason. But there's some problem in the JDK, which is a really old problem. And that one is discussed in those two Lucene issues. There's also bug open since 12, 15 years, something. I think it was open in 2005, and now they are working on that, but it's still not solved. The problem is, if you memory map that stuff and you close that file, the memory mapped buffers are not released because there could be still another thread accessing that code. And if you unmap that code, code accessing that virtually mapped file contents would get a segmentation fault because it's accessing something like an invalid pointer in the C language. So it would crash your JVM. And because of that, the JDK, the JVM waits until the garbage collector cleans up your resources. And the problem here is you have something like very, very small objects which are pointing to gigabytes of out of heap space. And those objects are very small. And if you have a running Zola server, which is running since days, those small objects are in the heap, but they're never eligible for a garbage collection because for the garbage collector, they are simple, small objects, and they are there's no reason to remove them, so they're staying in the old generation. Means the file can never be closed. And another thing is, for example, on Windows, you cannot even delete the segments using that. And because of that, Lucene in the memory map directory only enables that if there's a hack into the JDK where it can forcefully unmap those memory mapped regions. And for that, of course, it has to access private APIs. And it started to no longer work with Java 9. So that means if you would upgrade your Zola server to Java 9, it would not. It would be suddenly a lot slower because the memory mapping cannot be used anymore. So here's some code of that. I'm not sure if you can read it, but basically this one, the original code was doing something. You have a direct byte buffer, and there's a private method on this direct byte buffer that you can call, that you can get a cleaner, which is something which is normally only called by the garbage collector, though that's a hook by the garbage collector. So when the garbage collector collects the object to put it into trash, it calls that clean method, and that one then releases the system resources that we're mapping. And the trick here is simply to get access to this private method, works until Java 8, and then the comment here is actually the code that is executed, but for performance reasons and also pre-compiling it, it's done with method handles since a long time. I think with the change to Java 7, we implemented that with method handles. The reason for that is because you cannot be sure that this works, and it's quite a complex logic. You have a non-null check and all that stuff. So if you do that by reflection, it's the likelihood you cannot figure out at the beginning when your program starts that it actually works. And because of that, it tries to compile that in a method handle, so it knows from the beginning that this call will work, and you have all the rights to do this. And because of that, it compiles it. So basically, this is compiling this small piece of Java code into bytecode, and then it's returning that. But this is a code from Java 8. As you see here now, we are doing stuff like you see here at some point it's accessing the cleaner object, and you see here the set accessible true there. And if you do that with Java 9, it does not work anymore. And the second thing is because of the internal changes, they removed that method. So the problem is you cannot access that class. With the private APIs, it's completely gone. And because of that, that does not work anymore. And this is now the Java 9 code. I don't want to tell too much about it, but it's very funny here because you know that class sunmiskunsafe, which everybody tells you you should not use anymore because it's deprecated and won't and will go away in the future. The funny thing is here, this code adds a new method to a deprecated API. And the reason for that was because we have the close communication to the Oracle and OpenJDK people, and we told them, there's this 15-year-old bug. This is still not fixed, and we have no solution to unmap that. And this would completely break Lucene, Zola, Elasticsearch, and many other projects like Cassandra. In a similar way, we need a solution for that. And because for backwards compatibility, they have still access to the unsafe class, they have they simply said, okay, this is already unsafe, so if you unmap your stuff, you can crash the JVM. So we can use the unsafe class to protect all that stuff, so normal access checks are working, but they have the backwards compatibility, so the old code for getting the unsafe still works, so the fset accessible here works in that case because this is on the whitelist included inside the module system, so you can access that. That's on the whitelist, but you still need the access for the security manager, and at the end, we are just checking that, and if it does not work, you also get an information message. But this was the only part of Apache Lucene which was a little bit tricky. To make it work. And if you look at the issue, I'm not sure if it will be done for Java 11, but I was talking on the FOSDEM conferences with the Oracle developers. There are some ideas how to solve the problem with the unmapping of that, and hopefully this will help a lot of projects doing off-heap stuff, which rely on the garbage collector to do that. And there's an issue in the OpenJDK, and David Haley is hopefully working on that. The problem is it needs some changes, big changes in the JDK about the memory model of the JVM. And as you know, this takes longer than half a year. Still, also with a new release schedule. So we are hoping for that. But they agreed on that unsafe will be available until this is also solved. So that's something. So that was the most complex part here. I think now you can relax and lie back. So there are some other changes that might be interesting for some of the code, which is compact strings. So Lucene code does not use strings at all, so it's not really interesting. But on the Solar side, there's a lot of string stuff going on. So there's something, it has now compact strings, so internally it stores all strings which only contain ISO 8859 characters. So yeah, I'm not sure if this is the best choice to do that, but it stores it in a compact form, so it only uses 1 byte per character, not 2 bytes. So that's something. So if you're going to Java 9, your Solar server might use a lot less memory afterwards, so heap space. So you can reduce it. I'm not sure about Elasticsearch. Simon, are you using string class? Not much. Okay. So that's something. But there's also some other thing, and now I'm also coming a little bit to Elasticsearch, because that's very interesting, something like that. If you compile your code for Java 9, you know internally that this type of code is creating a string buffer internally, and then it uses string buffer, a string builder, append, and then it puts a hello in it, and then 1, 2, 3 as an integer, and all that stuff. But this is, of course, very expensive, so there was always a reason, don't concat strings like that, because it's too slow. But this is now changing, because they're now also using the invoke dynamic for that. So basically, at the end, it calls, it does an invoke dynamic like it does for the lambdas to concat that string, and it dynamically generates a method with exactly the signature you would need here. And I'm just telling that because that was also interesting. So I'm coming now to Elasticsearch. So for example, if Elasticsearch detects that you're running on Java 9 already since version 5.4, I don't know, when the painless scripting language was introduced, your code is compiled to do that. And I think people are using a lot of strings in their painless scripts. So this might help here. So if you have something like a scripting language, and as far as I remember, I was talking with them, this is the first scripting language on Earth that was using that. So the Groovy people are still, they have no idea how to do that. But that's something which is also interesting, though this is for good for the performance. And here, finally, I also have some funny detail. There was a patch, now I'm coming back to Solar, that was looking like that. And does anybody know why this patch was needed? This is the simple post tool, which is the tool that you have to use when you just want to push some data into your Solar cluster with the command line. You're using that simple post tool. And the reason for the simple post tool was it has no external references, so you can just take the class file and execute it, and it should work without any class pass or something like that. And there was this strange code, and if you look at that, it was using Java X bind data type converter. Does anybody know what happened here? Yeah. It still compiled, but when you try to execute that, it said, no, does not work, because the module is not there. The reason for that is, in the default configuration of the JDK, they already removed a lot of modules by default, and that was the XML code for data binding. I think it's YAXP. That's something for data binding. And the strange thing was, because in earlier Solar, in earlier Java versions, there was no Base64 class. All of you know that. That is shipped with the JDK, and because of that, this code used the data type converter to create the Base64 encoded stuff. Although we were already on Java 8, just somebody forgot about using the new Java 8 Java util Base64 to encode that. So that was just a funny detail, because suddenly one of the preview builds failed because they changed that code. So you have to keep in mind, not everything of the JDK is available anymore. Even public APIs may get removed by default. So you can execute that code, but you have to give some additional command line operations to do that. So that's something which is very funny. There were also some performance critical stuff, like hotspot changes, which is very good for Lucene. So for example, with Java 9, unfortunately, there was a bug at some point, so it was not like that, but now byte buffers are the same speed as arrays. So it doesn't make any difference if you have an standard byte array in your code, if you have a byte buffer and using the get and put methods on it, it's almost, in most cases, once it's optimized, it's exactly the same speed because some additional operations. So that means that now with memory map directory sorting, for example, works as if the doc values fields would be loaded into the heap space. There's not really a big speed difference anymore. There's also some other stuff which leads to the second interesting part is in Java 9, they added some additional intrinsics for bounce checks and array comparisons and array differences, which are very important for Lucene because we are doing that all the time. We are checking that the iterator is the doc ID that iterator is smaller, the document ID is smaller than something. For compressing, we're using array comparisons. And I think a lot of code is looking like that. And in previous versions of the JDK, there was some optimizations in it. So the hotspot optimizer was able to detect that type of code and then improve it. So for example, it could be that you have the check in your own code when you have a method exposed and you do some check like that. And then this method does some transformations of some input attributes and then calls another method inside the JDK. Of course, as a JDK needs to be safe, it's doing exactly the same check. And the problem here is, so you're doing the same index checks multiple times during the call stack until you go to the lowest level. And Hotspot was trying to optimize that away, but it's very, very hard. And because of that, they implemented a new, for example, for this check index, there's now in Java util objects, or is it an arrays? I think it's in arrays. There's a new method check index where you give it an index and a length, and it does exactly that what we have seen here. But it's a method call, so everybody would say that must be slower because it's a method call. No, the stuff is it. So the hotspot optimizer detects that as a call to this method, and then it starts to optimize it, so it inlines it into the code. And if you have a method that calls that and then dives down, it will figure out that the same check is done three times during calling one method to the next one, and so it can remove that completely. So it makes it easier, and that's the reason why you should now, if you're upgrading your code to Java 9, use that new methods. And don't think about it's slower because it's a method call. It's not the case, so you should use that one. There are other methods in a similar way. And so how do we do that in Lucene? There was the question, yeah, the problem is it's a new method in Java 8. In Java 9, how should I compile that? So it works with Java 9, but still backwards compatible with Java 8. So Robert Mier and I were doing that. So what we did was we implemented those methods, as we see here, with this spec in our own classes. So we added a new Java class that does exactly the same like this check index, but not in an optimized way. And this one is the code that we have in our source code. So and then we are starting to recompile those classes for Java 9 using the new methods, and then you're building a multi-release char. As far as I know, also Elasticsearch is also using multi-release chars, but for other reasons. And then here, for example, the LZ4 compression, which is used when reading and storing stored fields, is then using a separate class instance in the char file automatically. So when Java 9 loads the class from the Lucene core file, it first looks if there is under meta-inf services versions. So starting from Java 9, it would not read it from the conventional place where it would always read the class. Instead, it's reading that LZ4 class from another subdirectory of the char file automatically. If it does not find the class there, then it goes to the code, so the standard code down there. So you see here in the compressing module, it's only LZ4. And this helps, so it uses the optimized code. But now, how do we do the optimized code? So, for example, this is here from the LZ4. There we have this common bytes method for, you need that for the compression using LZ4. And there's something like future arrays mismatch in here. Yeah, we say, no, what does future arrays mean? Yeah, future arrays is, in our case, the replacement class for that method with exactly the same signature, which is part of the Lucene code. And when we are then packaging the char file, we're taking the bytecode and rewrite that class a little bit and remove that future here. Of course, we also change the class name and store it. So we don't even compile that and a second time. We are just changing the name of the signature in the class file for the method. And this is done by some Groovy script after the compilation. So first it compiles the code. So in the source code, we have that one. But then after the compilation, the class files that came out of the compiler are changed to use the real Java version. We only have to take care that the signatures of the method matches exactly. But for that, we have tests afterwards. So that's something that is really tricky. I'm not sure. I wanted to write a blog post about that, maybe if you also want to do the same. It's really useful if you have only static methods that you want to replace. So just implement your own implementation of the static method, and then in the bytecode, just patch the class files on the Java 9 code to call the different one. Yeah, then there's also some changes now, again, a little bit simpler, the garbage collector, which you have to keep in mind. So with Java 9, the G1 GZ garbage collector is the default. So when you start up Java 9 or later, it uses G1 GZ by default. But for Zola and Elasticsearch, you don't need to reconfigure your stuff because it's in the startup script. It's hard-coded, the garbage collector. So there's a CMS collector used. But you have to keep in mind that when you start up Zola, that you get this warning. Don't care yet. It's not to be removed. I think it will survive until Java 8. 11, up until Java 11, so it should be fine. So now the question is, why should you upgrade your cluster to Java 9? So there's one thing. If you're already using the G1 GC, then you have lower pause times. That's significantly, I think, 40% in most cases, it improved. So the other stuff is because of the module system, you have a little bit more of security, because if you are installing some bad plugins, they cannot start to hack your Java internals anymore, if you, of course, run your JDK with the correct flags. So you don't even need the security manager. On Elasticsearch, it's even better, because you have both of that. And then you get a slightly improved performance for some queries because of that intrinsics you have seen. And for example, the compression of large blobs during the indexing is also faster. We did some benchmarks on poor Lucene code, so I have no idea how much it impacts Elasticsearch or Zola, because there's a lot of stuff going on top of that. But the LZ4 compression of the source field in the Elasticsearch JSON should be faster, so indexing is better. And if you're doing sorting or faceting on doc values fields, if you use the memory mapped directory, which I think all of you use, it should be a lot faster. And now the final thing is about the support, because that's the questions I have seen a lot already. So what comes? So Java 11 will come out in September. And this one is a special release because it's a long-term support release. So most of you, today in the morning, we had a talk by the Elasticsearch people about Elasticsearch possibly switching in the next major version to Java 11. The reason for that is because it's a long-term release. Java 9 is no longer supported, so there are no bug fix releases anymore, so you have to go to Java 10 anyways. And because of that, I call it always Java 9 and Java 10 was to fix somehow the developers to do the start and do some testing. And then when Java 11 comes out, everybody takes care and the major companies will start upgrading. For example, Ubuntu 18.04 is already shipping with Java 10 as a default JVM, but it will switch to Java 11, including its LTS support afterwards, which is really strange for Ubuntu that it changes. And there will be no more Java 9 and 10 releases. And think about it, Java 8 has end of support in January next year. So you should look into moving to Java 11 as soon as possible. But that's just standard schedule. I think shortly after the release of Java 8, they deprecated Java 7. But if you're using Ubuntu or Red Hat packages, you have much longer support for that stuff. So Ubuntu has LTS support still for Java 8, so don't care about that. But from the official standpoint of Oracle, it's like that. So the summary here is now the minimum version of Lucene. For the time being now, there are no plans yet to change that, will be Java 8. Full runtime support for Java 9 was provided with Lucene and Zola 7.0. Already 6.6 is also working, but Zola is not working because the startup script is broken. You know, string comparing, you're calling Java version and then you compare if the string returned by that is returning the correct version number, and this code was buggy and because of that it did not work. The speed improvements by the multi-release chars are in Lucene Zola 7.3, and for the Zola people, support for Java 10 and later is in Zola 7.3, but the reason for that is again the startup script, which we're doing string starts with. Yeah, I think so. Forget about that. The reason for that is that was also the reason why there is only Windows 10 and no Windows 9. I think everybody knows why that is the case, because some code was checking for Windows 95 and was doing something like, if version number starts with Windows 9. Okay, yeah, that was everything about that change. And I think we have one question or something like that.
Sure, let's thank Uwe for his talk. There's time for questions. Are there questions?
Come on. So who is intending to upgrade soon, or who have already upgraded some Zola or Elasticsearch cluster to later versions than Java 8? Nobody. Okay. Start working on it. Okay.
So coming back to the GC topic, in Java 10 they introduced the parallel full GC. Have you done any benchmarks on that already, or?
What do you mean the parallel?
So G1C, the full GC was single threaded before, and now it's parallel threaded. Do you have any or recommendations or no hopes?
I have not yet looked. So I was doing the test with Java 9 and there was only the pause times, but I think that's also the background behind the slower pause times. So also the Elasticsearch people will kill me. My recommendation is in most cases use G1 GC because it's not broken anymore. It's more, I think, some support issue that they still recommend to use the CMS. But it would be a good idea to do some performance testing. So in any case, if you with a standard Zola configuration have something like a Zola node is hanging for a longer time, I would really suggest to switch to G1 GC as a first step instead of trying to tune the CMS collector. But you have to keep in mind that G1 GC is still a little bit slower than than CMS collector because it's doing more stuff in parallel, so which reduces performance a bit. Some people said up to 10%, but I think it's something around 5% slower for throughput.
All right, there's one more question here.
So thank you very much. It was really interesting. So regarding the string concatenation in Java 9 that you explained, so I didn't know exactly that they did that. that they replace it in this way. So the question is, do you know why they did it? Because you mentioned that there's a performance decrease, right?
I forgot to talk about that, but the reason for that is, so the first I have to tell you, you have to compile against Java 9 because the Java C compiler has to create the bytecode for that, of course. Mm-hmm. So if you're compiling with compatibility for Java 8, it won't help you. So it does not work for existing code. You have to compile against that. And so in that case, it only works with a painless scripting language which compiles the stuff on time. So the reason for that is, the problem is if you have that code is doing that concatenation, you have the problem you don't know in front how long the resulting string might be, and you also have to create a string builder object, then you have to append the stuff, and you know if you know the string builder code, it first allocates some char array, and then it grows the char array because it doesn't know how big it is. And here for that one, if it uses the concat method, this one, there's also a second concat method, which is more like the C-based printf method. Mm-hmm. So it has something, all the static parts like hello is a concatenated string, is a fixed string where you just have some placeholders in between and then it inserts the code. And because of that, it can already allocate the memory of the size it wants to do. And because of that, it's better also for the garbage collector.
Okay, so you mean it's more efficient in terms of memory, but it's slower. Okay, yeah. Clear. Thank you.
All right, let's thank the speaker again.
Okay.